Okay, I think we can start. Francesco will come in a few minutes, I think. Okay, so welcome to this class. We will see today how to design a blade for a turbine. Can you hear me or do I need some microphone? It's okay? Okay, so I think that the last session you had some notes about the aerodynamics. This time we will see the mechanical design of a turbine, most of all the blades. So, how many of you are aeronautical engineer? Aeronautical engineer. How many of you are aeronautical? Okay, no one. Okay, so we will start with some notes about the engine. So we will see how does an engine work, and then we will focus on the turbine. So we will deep dive inside the design of the blade. Let's start with the engine. How does an engine work? An engine is a simple machine, actually. It injects air by the speed of the airplane, and then he ejects the same air faster. It's all like that. So the engine increases the speed of the air, so he applied a force to the air. So as a reaction of this force, he got the thrust. So at the end, the thrust of an engine is what he ejects, that is actually the air, plus a small amount of fuel here, multiplied by the speed of the exit plane. This has to be subtracted by the mass of the air at the inlet multiplied by the speed of the inlet. So actually it's what is ejected minus what is ingested by the engine. As I was telling you before, the mass of fuel is so small respect to the mass of air. So here, in this sum, we can neglect the fuel and take only the air because it's huge in respect to the fuel. So we can simplify this formula, and actually the thrust is the mass flow of the air multiplied by the difference of speed at the exit respect to the inlet. That's all about the thrust, maybe. So, how does an engine work? An engine is made by five modules. These modules are the air intake, the compressor, the burner, the turbine, and then the nozzle. The air intake takes the air from the ambient, and then it makes a first compression to the fluid. Then you have a compressor that, of course, compresses the air, and you need to have the fuel to have combustion. So you have a burner in which you transform the chemical energy of the fuel in temperature, in another form of energy. Now at this time you have a turbine. That is the scope of this session. What does the turbine do? The turbine expands the fluid. But why we need to expand the fluid? We need to drive the compressor, because the compressor, to compress the air, needs some energy, some work. So we need a component, a module that provides this work to the compressor. The turbine has this job. So the turbine extracts the work from the air, from the mass of air flowing into the engine, and with a shaft that here is reported, is connected to the compression, to the compressor, and it drives the compressor. At the end of the engine, we have the nozzle that accelerates the air into the engine to produce the increase of speed at the exit of the engine. So, this is a chart in which you can see the cycle of an engine. In the y-axis, you see the temperature of the air, while in the x-axis, you see the entropy. It's a common chart for an engine, aeronautical engine cycle. So, at the start, you have air from the ambient, so the starting point of our cycle. Then, you have the air intake, so you have the first transformation, from 1 to 2. So, how I was telling you before, the air intake does the first compression of the air. So, at the end, you have a rise in pressure and, of course, a rise in temperature. You cannot, so the point change from 1 to 2, the temperature is increasing. The entropy is also a little bit increasing, not so much, because the entropy describes how much you are wasting in your transformation. The air intake is it's not wasting so many energy. So at the end is quite constant, the entropy is a little bit increasing, but not so much. Then you have the compressor. The compressor does another compression of the air. So this time the compression is much higher than the ones provided by the intake. So you have another transformation from 2 to 3, in which you can see a rise in pressure, and here in this chart a rise in temperature. This time the compression is much more anisentropic. So you can see here what will occur if the process was ideal. So a rise in temperature without any change in entropy. But in the real cycle, in the reality, we have some waste of energy that makes the entropy rise. Okay. Oh. And another thing that you can see here, changing from the ideal cycle to the real cycle, is that the temperature is increased. It's so sensible, so this picture. So, because why? Because every loss of energy at the end becomes temperature. So, from the ideal cycle to the real cycle, you see an increase of temperature. Then the burner. The burner gives a heat to the fluid at the end. So, here you can see an increase of temperature from 0.3 to 0.4. This curve is, you cannot see here if you are not familiar with this chart, but this curve is an isopressure curve. So the pressure is not changing in the burner. You are wasting only a little bit of pressure because of the transformation, because of losses, but the ideal curve here, the dotted line, is an isopressure curve. Then you have the turbine. The turbine does the opposite of the compressor. So you have an expansion of the fluid and then a drop of temperature here. So from the ideal cycle, you go from 0.5 to 0.4 to 0.5, and then you have this drop of temperature and pressure. In the real cycle, you have an increase of entropy and an increase of temperature, as I said before. Here, the work made by the turbine is proportional to this vertical drop. It's actually this vertical drop multiplied by the Cp of the gas. And it is equal to the compressor, because what? Ah, number 8 is not here, because sometimes you have another component that is not present here in this kind of engine. It is a conventional numeration of the station of the engine. So you have some time, we will see it later. Okay, so at the end you have the nozzle that expand the fluid, making from pressure energy speed. So it accelerates the fluid. Okay, this is the turbojet. So the air came from here, then you have the compressor that is mainly made by blades that rotating give energy to the fluid. Then you have the combustion chamber that increases the temperature to the fluid, and the turbine. The turbine takes the works from the fluid and drives the compressor through this shaft. And then you have the nozzle that increases the speed of the air. Okay, so how to evaluate the performance of the engine? So you start from the energy of the fuel, that is the available power, that here is written that it is the mass of fuel that you are consuming multiplied by the chemical power of the fuel. Then this available power became the power transferred to the jet. But in this transformation, because you see before the cycle you have some waste of energy, you not all of the available power become power to the jet. You have an efficiency of the cycle. This is called thermodynamic efficiency. This power to the jet is not all useful to the propulsion, because some power is wasted in accelerating the air. So you have propulsion power, propulsive power, and a dissipated power. So the jet power is simply the sum of the propulsive power and the dissipated power. The propulsive power is easy, is the thrust multiplied by the speed of the airplane, that is actually the speed of the inlet of the engine. The dissipated power, what is it? The dissipated power is the energy that the fluid has when it exits from the engine, because you are accelerating the air. So at the end, you have an air that is moving. And when you take the air from the inlet, the tail was not moving. So you are giving energy to the air. This air is not useful, this energy is not useful to the propulsion. So it is a dissipated power that is not needed from the thrust, from the propulsion of the engine. So the ratio between the propulsive power and the jet power is called the propulsive energy efficiency. Sorry. Okay. So let's talk about this efficiency. The thermodynamical efficiency depends only from the cycle. And with cycle, I mean the, how much you are compressing the air in the compressor, how much is the maximum temperature then you can get inside the turbine, so the maximum temperature at the exit of the burner. And depends also from other parameters like the speed of flight, the Mach, because if you are going faster, you are compressing much more from the air intake that has an higher efficiency respect to the compressor. And then it depends also from the exit condition for the nozzle. It depends of the from the pressure at the air at the outlet. But I don't want to focus so much about the thermodynamic efficiency. It's more important for us now the propulsive efficiency. The propulsive efficiency is the ratio between the propulsive power and the power to the jet. Here you can see that the propulsive power is the thrust multiplied the speed at the inlet, and this is the formulation of the power of the jet. Simplifying this, this equation, we obtain these results. That is quite simple. We have only two contributes. The one is the speed of the air at the inlet of the engine. And it is a fixed parameter. We cannot play on this parameter because it is actually the speed of flight of the airplane. This is a fixed parameter. If we want to raise the propulsive efficiency, we only can play on the speed at the outlet condition of the engine. So, because these terms is at the denominator, if we want to raise the propulsive efficiency, we need to decrease this contribute. We need to decrease the speed at the outlet of the engine. But to make thrust, the engine has to accelerate accelerate air. So how can I do to have the same thrust reducing the speed at the exit? I have to raise the mass flow in the engine. So because, let's come back to the first slide, the thrust is the mass flow multiplied by the difference of speed. If I want to have constant this term and I want to drop this term, I have to raise this other term. So, another kind of energy that is the evolution of the turbojet is the turbofan. The turbofan play on this fact that we want to accelerate not so much a huge amount of energy of air. So, how does a turbofan works? He have a first fan that here it is this huge row of blades that does a compression, a little compression for the air. It ingests a lot of air, but not all this air does the cycle that we saw before. A little portion actually of the air does the cycle that we saw before. The other part of the air takes only the compression of the fan and then has a nozzle. So here, this is the monster of the air ingested by the engine that has only the compression of the fan and then go out from the engine through this nozzle, and it is accelerated not so much. Then the other part of the air go through the grazie.
You're welcome.
Go through the to the core of the engine and does the same cycle that we saw before. So there is the compressor. Here you can see two different compressors. The low pressure compression, you have two compressions. One when the fluid has not so much pressure, and it is this one. Then the other that it is on compression when the pressure is high, and we have the high pressure compression. So you have here the combustor and then turbines. If you have two compressors, you have two turbines, one that drives the high pressure shaft and then the other that drives the low pressure shaft. These other turbine drives also the fan, and this is important because he has to provide a lot of work, because he has to drive the fan that moves a lot of air. Okay, so let's have a look to this cycle of the engine. It's quite similar to the one that we saw before. The only difference is here that you have a fan here reported. And the other difference is that you have here two turbines. Here it is reported only a compressor, but you have usually two compressors, one of low pressure, one of high pressure. The difference in the cycle is here, in this part, in the first part. Here you have the dynamic compression of the air intake. Then you have the fan, a little bit compression of the fan. You can see that the compression of the fan is much lower compared to the compression of the compressor. Then a part of the fluid, the great portion of the fluid, directly expand here. And it produces the increase of speed that we need to the thrust. And for your question, you was asking the point 8. In some case, we have that the secondary flow that here is flowing out of the engine. In some case, it can mix with the core flow. So you have a mixing chamber that connects the secondary flow with the core flow. You have to play with pressure. It's not so easy, but in a military engine, it's often like that. And the point 8 is the mixing chamber. Okay? So I was saying the most part of the fluid is doing this little cycle that produces the greater parts of the thrust. The smallest part of the fluid is providing actually energy to the great part. And that is how a turbofan works. Okay, so this is how a turbofan looks like in reality. This is a 3D model here with all the components. This is a section of this engine. It is a real engine, so while this was only a scheme, it is a real engine cross-section. This is called cross-section. You have the component that I was saying before, so the fan that accelerates the secondary airflow, that is the huge part of the air. So the fan give the compression, and then here you have the exit of the air, the secondary nozzle. Then here you have the booster, the low pressure compressor. The air, the core flow come into this flow path. And then you have the second compressor, that is the high pressure compressor. Here you can see that because the pressure is increasing, the area of the section that is the flow path for the air is reducing, because the air is the same, but the pressure is increasing, so you need less section for the mass flow. Then you have the burner. Here you inject the fuel, and then you get the increase of temperature. After the burner, you have the HPT, that is the high pressure turbine. The high pressure turbine drives the high pressure compressor. It is the hottest part of the engine, except for the burner. And it is actually a critical module, a critical component, because in the burner, yes, you have high temperature, but there are only static parts, you don't need any rotating parts. In the high pressure turbine, you have the same temperature, a little bit lower because you can cool from here, but you have also a lot of centrifugal stresses because the high pressure turbine is rotating at a high speed. So you have a lot of centrifugal stresses. It's a quite complicated module. Then you have another turbine, that is the low pressure turbine, that is driving the low pressure compressor and the fan.
So, how many of you have already seen this before? Everyone? Is there here someone who was not aware of what Marco was telling you? Okay, you were not. What you really need from this speech, no, is that we are working. We work the next days on which part? Yeah, you know. We'll ask you to work on a specific part here, that is the low pressure turbine. No? Turbines are similar. There is another turbine here, Marco just told you.
Yeah.
Anyone know here which is the other turbine? The other turbine is the HPT. The H is for high pressure turbine. The second one is the low pressure turbine. Why high and low? No? Because if you think to the pressure, the high, of course everyone knows this is the engine below the wings, no? And the airplane is flight. So you have the pressure that is the total pressure at the inlet in front of the fan, no? Then a part of the air goes to bypass the core of the engine and will provide most of the propulsive thrust. But in order to do that, you have to push the fan. Who push the fan? The LPT. How? With a shaft. No? So, an LPT, a turbine. A turbine is something really easy. You have a shaft. In this case, you are linking the LPT for the turbine to the fan. The fan is increasing the pressure at the inlet, but in order to increase the pressure, you need work. And the work is given from LPT. No? If you increase the pressure, what will happen? If we close the door and we increase the pressure in this room, what it happens if I open the door? The flow will go out, no? Because we try to recirculate the same pressure. So a lot of air from this room will go outside, okay? And we'll use the same, because going outside, the flow will accelerate, will gain velocity. And so we increase the pressure, and then we move it to the exit of the airplane, increasing the velocity and giving thrust to the engine. This is how the engine works. But in order to do that, I need to give power to the fan, to move it. So I tie the fan to a shaft, and the LPT is responsible to do that. How a turbine works? A turbine is really easy, is you are still using the pressure. As I said, here you have atmospheric pressure, then you increase it here, then you have another compressor that increases it more, nothing done on the burner. The burner is a combustor, you are just heating with the flame the air, so you are increasing temperature, but not significantly the pressure. And after the burner, you you have very high pressure, no? How for the fan, the booster, the first compressor, and the HPC, high pressure compressor. Who is giving power to the high pressure compressor? The IPT, the high pressure turbine. So, how is working a turbine? How is possible that the turbine will give power to the compressor? The turbine, at the end of the turbine, you have high temperature and high pressure. What you can do is to use what I just told you. You open a door and the flow is wishing to go in that direction, would like to go outside the door. But while the flow is going in this direction, from where you have high pressure to the exit, where the pressure is the ambient pressure at the gate you are flying, what you can do is to drive this pushing of the flow toward the exit in a specific way. So you put static profiles and rotating profiles. The static profiles, what we do is to compare the flow, instead of going straight in this direction, to be pushed towards the rotating ones. So I change this direction, moving those this way, pushing towards the rotors that will be made in motion, will be made in rotation, no? And so the rotors will take this air that is being accelerated by the vanes and then push it, then goes here, and then start to move. Moving around, but in order to do that, for the physics principle, they'll give a force, but then the flow also will be deflected. And so, at the inlet will have this direction, at the outlet this. Always push by the pressure in this direction. You'll put another vane that will push again towards another row of rotors, and so on. You have several stages, you see those. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 in that design. No? Those are all done by static profiles. So you have profiles which take the flow and accelerate towards rotors, that instead will push by this air that has been accelerated by the first static row, And they mean name in movement. But because the rolls, the rotating rolls, are tied to the shaft, how you show
here.
So all are tied, all the rotors are tied together, and they are tied to the shaft by that component that is the cone shaft. So all the rotors of the LPT will move a shaft, a tube, that will connect, take the rotating movement to the fan. The fan will work exactly in the opposite way of a turbine, and will transform this movement in pressure, increasing the pressure. So the turbine is using the pressure to transform pressure in movement, acceleration, and so torque. Instead, the fan will use the torque to increase the pressure. So the pressure in the turbines will drop. Instead, in the fan will increase. Am I generating energy? I said that here I use the torque, the power generated by the turbines to increase the pressure. And here I'm using the pressure to generate the power. There is something strange here. I miss the fuel. No? Because in order to do that, I have to give feed to the process, and I do that with the fuel, the combustor, this part. Because what I do here is increasing the temperature strongly. I give a fuel, I burn the flow, and I increase the temperature. Increasing the temperature, I increase the enthalpy. And so I give energy to the turbines to do the work I described. No? And the temperature, instead, in the turbine will decrease, using the temperature to transform the enthalpy in work and in water. So the only thing you have to know is that mainly this principle that you use pressure, giving a preferable way to the flow to go from the inlet of the turbines to the exit of the final nozzle from the engine. But instead of let the flow free to move in this direction, you accelerate, this, transform the velocity in rotational speed of the rotors that are tied to the shaft that are connected to the fan, and then accelerate again, and then again push the rotors, and so on. Anyone understood nothing of what I said? Anyone didn't understand that nothing at all? A lot. Okay. Bye.
Okay. So, let's have another look at this cross section. You see here some other components that are not highlighted, that are only structural part to make the structure stand up. So, now we are going to focus on the turbine. As Francesco was saying, the turbine has only the job to provide the power to the compressor and the fan, extracting power from the blade, like that. But the turbine has also other specifications from the customer. So as at the start of this lesson, I was talking about efficiency. So the turbine has to be efficient. In addition, we want a light turbine, because weight, you are taking the engine into an airplane. So if the engine is too heavy, it's not good for the aircraft. So the turbine and the engine, of course, has to be light, not so weight. You want also a cheap turbine. If you can, you should use the cheapest component, but you need to assure reliability of the turbine. This is the most important thing. The turbine should not fail. Okay, and also, and also the turbine should be the smallest as possible because of problem of engine mount, drag of the engine in the air, because of a lot of problems. So, this is the aerodynamic concept that Francesco explained before, so I skip this chart. Okay, and then here have a look at the detail of the cross-section of the turbine. So, here the air comes into the turbine from this part and go through this that is called the flow path, is the part when the hot air coming from the HPT comes and exit here to go to the nozzle. These are the blades, the rotating and the static blades. The rotating blades that I will call simply blades are here, are connected here to the shaft. This is a cone shaft, and then here to the main shaft to go to provide the work to the compressor and the fan. The static part, the static blade are here, are this other part that I will call nozzle, because actually they accelerate the flow to give the right angle of attack for the blades. So I will call nozzle the static blade and simply blades the rotating blades. So here you can see that all the rotating parts of the engine are connected here to the shaft from the bottom. And all the static parts are connected here to the upper part of the engine that is called case. That is important. Another thing that I want to highlight at this is this space. Previously I was saying that dimensions of the turbine is an important parameter. We want a turbine as small as possible to have a good performance of the aircraft. And so why should I waste this space? I could make the turbine lower. Because of performance. If I increase the radius of the turbine, the performance are higher, because the work extracted from the turbine is force multiplied by speed. The force is proportional to the timing of the air, but the more are the forces, the more are the losses. So if I want to have with the same work a high performance, I should reduce the force but increase the speed of rotation of the engine. So I can make the radius higher, and then the speed, that is omega, the rotational speed of the shaft multiplied by the radius. If I increase the radius, the speed increase, and also the work. So I can extract, increasing the radius, the same work with an higher efficiency. That's why I'm wasting all the space in the turbine. In addition, here, the turbine is a very hot part because the flow comes from the combustor and is very hot. So I need to cool some part, because otherwise life of the component is not assured at all. So here I have some cooling flow that comes from a cold part of the engine, that is usually the compressor, some stage, some portion of the compressor. And then here I use this cold air to cool this part that are called discs, that connect the blades to the shaft at the end. Okay, but have a look in detail to all the components of the turbine. So, the case. As I was saying before, all the static part of the turbine are connecting from the top. Actually, from the external part of the engine, because it is a 360, 360 portion, so at the bottom you are connecting from the bottom. So, all the static parts, let me say all the nozzles, so the static blades, are connected to the case. So the case connect the forces on the nozzle to the engine, to the mount of the engine to the aircraft, and it's used also to mount the turbine to the other portion of the engine. And you have also another important job. Here you have rotating blades. In some case, you don't want it happen, but sometimes it could happen. A blade can fail, so you can have a rupture in the blade. So the blade will explode and will impact for centrifugal forces here. It will be expelled from the shaft and go through the radial direction. We don't want that this part of the blades come into the aircraft. So the case have to be thick enough, resistant enough to contain a blade that is exploding and impacting outside. It is an important job of the case. Then here we have the shroud. So the case is an important part because connect all the forces to the engine. So all the static forces are passing through the case. So we have high load. We don't want to have high load and high temperature in the same component. So the shroud are a shield for the case. So here you have the flow path. So the high temperature flow that come into the turbine. This portion, this part that are the shrouds, are only tiles, not only, but that avoid a direct contact of the flow path of the hot air with the case. So you are shielding the case from the hot air. That is the main function of the shroud. Another function of the shroud is to carry this honeycomb. This honeycomb is a light part that need to increase the performance of the engine, reducing the wasted air, but we will see later. Okay, this is the conshaft. The conshaft is what connects the rotating parts to the main shaft, to the fan. No, there's no more. Okay, so this is a much more important part, the discs. What does the disc do? The discs are connected to the blades. So the discs are the only parts that make the blades rotating. They have to resist to the centrifugal forces of the blade. And it is a very important job because they are critical part, as I was saying before, because if you have a rupture, you have a part that is impacting the engine and the aircraft. So the disc must retain the blades, both radially and both axially, because the blades have also an important axial force that has to be compensated from some kind of reaction. And then they transmit the motion disc by disc to the conshaft and then to the shaft. Another component is the interstage seal that it is reported here. It is a component in between two discs. Its job is to reduce the losses here, but I will explain later with another chart, and shield the discs from the hot air as the shroud for the static parts. So you have here this portion that is shielding the discs that are an high stressed part because they have to contain to retain the blades. So they have to shield from the air coming from the flow that can escape here. There is always some air escaping from the flow path. They have to shield the disc from the hot air. In addition, you can use the cooling air that is in this portion of the turbine. You can do some slot here to make the air passing through this space. It is a small space, but there is. And so you can cool also the disc, the high-stressed part of the disc that it is this part, with this hair, making this path. Here is a little bit higher, you can see better. Okay, but okay, let's deep dive into the main purpose of this course, that are the blades, the nozzle and the blades. So the nozzle or veins are the static airflow. They don't extract work from the air, and they only deflect the flow for the rotating blades. The nozzles are made by three parts, three important parts. The upper part, that is called the outer band. The mid part, that is made by the airfoil. And the lower part, that is called inner band. Okay. The outer part of the vein, the outer band. What does it do? The outer part is the connection of the nozzle with the case here. You can see here this part. Here it is the connection. So in this part, in this portion of the nozzle, you can see three main components. One is the platform, that is this part. And in the 3D picture, it is this part. The platform is needed to have a guide for the flow. You need to have a path for the flow, so you need to build some wall to contain the flow inside your flow path. And this is its job. Then you have the hooks, that are these part, one and two. The hooks are needed to connect the nozzle with the case, to transmit all the forces in the lightest way that you can do. So they are used to have reaction for radial and axial forces. Here. This is the outer platform, the outer band of the knot, of the knot. These are the hooks and this is the platform. Here you have the case. Let me look. It is something like that. This is the case. So from the airfoil that are here, down, I'm not interested here in this part, you have forces from the air. You have an axial force, a component of a radial force, and you have, of course, a tangential force that here I'm not drawing. So, this part of the... This part of the nozzle has to react to these forces and moment. So you will have a reaction here in this direction and another reaction here. Okay. So here you are reacting to the forces made by the flow. For the axial component, you have here another reaction. This is how the outer part of the nozzle works. But from the flow, you have also an eye component that is the tangential part of the force. because you are deflecting the flow and you have, so of course, some forces in the tangential direction. Here you have this lot. Seeing from the top, this part from this side, I have this part, this lot. I use a pin here connected to the case, usually here, something like that, to react to the tangential forces. It is enough. It's quite simple. Okay. So, the inner part. Inner part has also a platform to guide the flow, the same job as before. And then it has here another part that is called the honeycomb carrier, because here you have a static part and a rotating part that are very near. You want to reduce the gap between static part and rotating parts to avoid air coming out the flow path. And you want to reduce this air adding a light metal, that is this structure that is made by hexagonal cells. So there is sheet metal here, but here there is not metal, it is empty. So it is a very light material. But I will explain later this part. And then here I will say something about the interlocking. You have one nozzle here, one segment of nozzle, and then you have the adjacent one here. Here you have the inner band. In this part, you create a zone in which two nozzles are in contact. Usually you don't want contact between parts because with thermal expansion you will generate stresses. But here you create a zone in which the two nozzles, adjacent nozzles, are exchanging some forces. This is needed to damp some vibration of the engine. If you have forces, you have friction. And so if you have a vibration, with this friction you can damp this vibration. Okay, and now let's see the blade, the rotating parts. Their job is to extract work from the air. Also, for this component, we can divide in three parts. The tip shroud, that is the external part, the airfoil, and the root. For the nozzle, we have many airfoil in the same part. For the blades, we have only one airfoil usually. Sometimes you can find more than one airfoil, but it's not common. Usually we have only one airfoil in the blades.
Yeah, a complete row is none of the several airfoil,
yeah.
No?
Yeah. Okay, so the tip shroud of the blade. The tip shroud is made by three main components. One is the platform, as always. We have always a platform to have a guide for the fluid. Then we have some fin. Here there are these teeth that have the job to cut the honeycomb, to reduce air coming out from the flow path. Why we need this kind of thing? Because from the front to the back of the blade, we are a drop of pressure. So we have the blade here, we have a high pressure here, and a low pressure here. So the air want to go from the high pressure to the low pressure. So, fortunately, the most part of the air will be detected by the blade that will pass here, where the job is extracted. But a little bit portion of the air doesn't want to do the work, because it's easier go without doing any work for the air. So it will pass here over the blade without being deflected by the blade roll. So without producing any work. And it is a waste of energy, it is an efficiency for the turbine. What we want to do with this fin? We want to reduce this waste of air. So, you have the honeycomb, that is the light material. The blades have these teeth. In the operative condition, you have thermal expansion, you have centrifugal forces, so the blade is moving, and it will move higher than the static part. So it will cut the honeycomb. You will have here a portion of the honeycomb that is broken. You will not have this honeycomb anymore. So on the top of the hair, you will have this condition. This is the static part that is broken in this way. And this is the blade, the rotating part. Now, the hair that want to escape from the flow path has to do this path that is much more complicated than a straight path here. And what is happen? Doing this path, they are generating a lot of vortex. Vortex are losses for the hair. So this time they has a hard path here, because it has to do work to pass here, but now it has also another path here. So the hair now doesn't want to go here anymore. A little bit of hair we will go anyway in this direction, because you have always a gap between static and rotating parts. But the waste of energy is reduced a lot in this way. This is the function of this component, this fin here. That one. Okay, also in this part you have the interlocking here. So you have two blades, okay, two or more blades that are touching in this part, and the forces are exchanged and applied from a blade to the adjacent one. This is always to damp some vibration, as in the other component. Okay, the lower part of the blade is the root. We will always have the platform to guide the fluid, but this time have other three components. We have the shank, the angel wing, and the attach at the bottom, you can see here. The angel wing, what does they do? They have a similar job as the fin was seen before, because they have the job to make the harder for the air came out from the flow path. So here the air cannot go straight in this direction, but the air had to do some trouble to go out from the flow path. So we want to make this path harder for the air, and we introduce this kind of feature at the forward part of the blade and also in the outer part of the blade.
Okay, I try to summarize again. We try to do an exercise. What we'll ask you in the 8 hours of the final workout will be to design profile like those or a blade, but in a smart way, a different way. But before doing in a different way with respect to what we have done until now. Because if you look, this is really easy. It's a simple shape, no? Why? Because with the manufacturing, we were using a casting process where the melted material is pushed in a mold, no? You cannot do very strange things. But before you'll be able to do something incredibly new, you have to understand the main reason why we are doing this way and what they need, you know? I try to ask you and to make you think to what Marco said. So we have the turbine. Here we design our turbine that Marco reported here, no? But let's try step by step to understand the problem and how we have solved those problems, no? First thing I said, we enter with high pressure, we exit with the low pressure, the static pressure, and so we have a tendency of the flow to go in this direction, and we want to use these force that remove the flow to transform this in power. How we do that? We have vanes and blades. The vanes accelerate the flow, pushing the flow towards the blades that will move, changing again the verse of that velocity that will be again accelerated and strong. So this is why we have vanes and blades. Let us design some vanes and blades. Vane, this is a vane, this is a blade, this is another vane, this is a blade, and so on. Let's design a three-stage turbine. Okay, so this is a meridional view, what you are seeing there, no? This profile will be something like this, that will accelerate, if I cut it, that will accelerate the flow moving here, and this will be made a tangential force, so I have a complete row of those. So a vane, this part is something like this. I have a lot tied together and blades also, I don't remember. And the same for blades, I have a lot. I'm not finding anymore, but. Okay, but. Okay, so how I use, this is the main principle of working of a turbine. I transform delta pressure in velocity and then in work. Is this clear? Okay, but now I have a problem. If I just do the blades, first of all, they drop because I'm not sustaining those, no? But also the flow will not remain here, but will go away, no? I have high pressure here. If I have high pressure in this room, I open the door, it's going away. So I have to contain. I have to tell the air, remain here. Do this way, not go away. How I do that? I have to build a cone here. I have to contain the air inside the main flow part. And that's the top part, the casing. So I have a static container of the air. Okay? But I still have a problem. If I put here the vanes and the blades, I'm not sustaining those, they fall. No? So how I can sustain? I have this part that is a con. I can use those to start sustaining the veins. So the veins, this is a vein of the first stage, this is a vein of the second stage, this is the vein of the third stage. I tie the veins to the shaft. So these veins are linked to the casing, okay? The blades are pushed by the force. But I need that force that will make movement of those blades. But I want to take this force to the front of the engine where there is the fan. How can I do that? First of all, I have to connect all those forces. So I link all the blades. If you see below the blades that are blue, there are some arms that connect all. Look here. This is a better graph than mine, but below the blades, you see there are connections here that connect all the blades. Okay? So now all the blades will rotate at the same velocity. Each one pushed by the flow, making them rotating. And if I tie them all, I collect all these forces together, no? But now I have to take it to the fan. How I do that? You see there that at a certain point I take this to the shaft. And the shaft will go up to the fan. Okay, but now some other problems occur. Because, however, I tied these veins to the casing, but I said that the rotor will rotate. How fast? Very fast. In a low pressure turbine, they will rotate about 3000 RPM rotation per minute. No? Because they are really high, that's a problem. They are incredible fast rotating, no? So they generate incredible rotation centrifugal forces. Okay, I have a blade, like the one shown by Marco, that is rotating and is generating a centrifugal forces. How I can keep the blades where they are? The veins are stuck, are still, and I fix it to the casing. But I cannot fix this to the casing because the casing is fixed and the blades are rotating. No? So I have to find a way to keep them where they are, because if I left them free, they move towards the tip for the centrifugal stress. How I can do that? I transform a centrifugal force that is towards the top, no, in a tangential force. How? With the disc. The disc is a disc, so I don't know another word, a disc, no? Where I attach the blade. All the blades are attached around the disc and all are pushing in different directions towards the outside for the centrifugal stress, forces, no? This for, so maybe I have a disc and here I attach every single blade. And so on, all around. No? So I have a lot of centrifugal forces Here there is the shaft that will connect to the fan. And all these forces will be generating tangential forces, but because the disk is very solid, we'll be able to keep the forces and to keep the blades where they are. Am I being able more or less to explain? Okay. So here I have disk that are all around the 360, and so will transform the centrifugal stress in tangential stress and will keep the blades where they are. Okay, we have solved some problems. We are transforming the pressure in torque. We keep the air where it is. We are fixing the veins where they have to do and keeping the blades rotating where we want. We still have a lot of problems. Okay, the air is going from here to here, but the air is smart. I'm asking to go from here to here doing work. And because the air is lazy, they don't want to do what I'm asking for. I have to compare it to accelerate, rotate the blades, accelerate, rotate the blades, and so on. No? Because they take into account that this component is rotating. The casing is fixed, no? So, I have the necessity to have a gap here, no? They cannot be together tied, because they cannot touch. They are rotating 3,000 RPM. So here I have a gap. And the air will try to go, not doing the work, but we'll try to bypass by here. Is it clear? We'll try to go in this part. The air will try, instead of doing the work, will try to pass over here, and so on. Because this part is rotating, this part is fixed. How I can try to say to the air, don't do that? Let's do a zoom of here. So I have the casing, I have the blades that is rotating. The air will prefer to do this instead of accelerating, of moving the rotor here, in order to avoid this, but compare the air to go through here, even if it's difficult, I do this so that the air will be compelled to pass towards lower gap, and I generate some recirculation that will make things more difficult for the air to go in that direction. Okay? And this is the shroud, the fins, and so on. But I have another problem. These components are big, no? And they are dealing with very high speeds, rotational speeds, with high centrifugal stress, with high temperatures will make the components move, but what is more critical is that an airplane is not always flying at the same condition. You think that when you enter an airplane, the airplane is already, the engine are on, but they are making a very small work. So in that condition, that is idle, the engine, the temperature will be low, pressure will be low, rotational speed will be low. When you close the door, The airplane will go to the to start to fly over, no? And I will move on the wheels, and this is the taxi. So in order to do that, we'll increase a little the power. So RPM will increase a little the temperature and so on. When it will occur the cough, that is the max power, because you need really a lot of power to take the airplane off the... So there is where the temperature, the forces, the rotational speed will be higher inside the turbine. Then the airplane will start to go to the cruise altitude. And in that case, you need something in between, a little less. You are still rising, but you have not to accelerate from 0 to 800 kilometers per hour. No? So you have to keep the same velocity, but still rising the height. At the end, whenever you reach the altitude of cruise, you'll have to keep the same altitude. And so you reduce again the thrust and so on, temperature. What I'm telling you is that an engine is dealing with a lot of different conditions, different temperatures. And if you have such a big and complex component under different temperatures, it means that if you have higher temperatures, the component will increase geometrically. If the temperature, because it is large, no? Instead, the lower temperature will decrease. And the same for RPM, rotational speed. If they are higher, more centrifugal stress will tend to enlarge the component. No? And so on. So what I'm saying is that this component will not be in the same positions all over the flight, but will move radially and axially. I don't want, but this is the reality. I try to go against, but this is the reality. But this means that this gap, because the component will be driven by different force, this gap over the rotor, I have to keep it at least high enough that in the most critical condition, where this component increases more with respect to this, will not go to touch each other. No? How can I do? Because from one side I have to keep it at least high enough to prevent this. But on the other side, I want it as tight as possible to prevent the flow to go over. How I can do? The escamotage is to adopt here a material that can be cut because it's I don't remember the word. No, it can be broken. That is the Onicom. The Onicom is something where you have a lot of empty spaces and not a lot of material, no? So that you put this Onicom, that is that one, here, attached to the casing, so that when the rotors run there, in the minimum condition, when the rotors rise a lot and the casing not so much, the fins that I put here will cut the Onico, building its own position, and in this way I'll keep always the minimum gap, because I could keep the nominal gap lower then what will be the movement during the engine life, no? So in order to try to prevent this, I use the ONECOM here, here, and here. Are those the only gaps where a rotating part, the rotors, in the starting part, the statoaortic part, are in contact? Think a moment. You have blades linked to the tip, and blades linked to the hub below, towards the disc and the arms. Below the veins, under the veins, you have this part, what is this? The arm that are connecting the blades, which are rotating. And the veins here are instead still, no? So here you have another interface where you have a fixed and the rotating part. Exactly how this one. Here I have rotating and fixed, here I have fixed and rotating. No? So even here I need to prevent the flow to go this way. And I do exactly the same. ONECOM. I prefer always to put the ONECOM on the fixed part, so on the veins, and fins. So, I have tried to make you understand why I need static and rotating parts. Why I need the static and rotating? Because I want to I need a rotating part because I want to make the shaft here in movement to take for the thrust to the fan. And I need the static part to accelerate the flow and to move the flow towards the blades. Okay? Then I told you why I need the casing. I need the casing to contain the air here, to make the air go from here to here and not go where it wants. I also use the casing to fix the veins. Instead, for the blades, in order to prevent that the centrifugal forces will move them away, I use the disc, which transform centrifugal radial loads in tangential stresses that I can contain, making the disc quite fat. Then all the disc and the rotors are tied together to make all the thrust go through the conshaft and then the shaft to the front. Then I want to prevent the flow to go over here, where rotating part and static part are, and I adopt for these the fins. These fins that makes the flow less easy. And the ONECOM that prevent to be compelled to keep the gap too high due to the engine cycle during a flight. Idem I'm doing at the vein hub, where this time the flow could go after the rotor to bypass this way the vein. So I tied ONECOM here and fins here. Which is the velocity of the rotor? I told you for an MPT 3000 RPM. They need 3,000 times every minute around, no? Which is the velocity of the disc?
3,000 RPM.
Sorry?
Is it the same?
The same, of course, the same. no? Because they are linked. So the disks are rotating at the same velocity. Now, a blade is small, no? 1 kilogram. A disk is really, really heavy. And it's rotating at this velocity. Because there are really high temperatures, if a blade breaks, let's suppose that due to this high temperature and centrifugal stresses, a blade breaks here. No? But a blade is 1 kilogram. If at the up, at the bottom, it breaks, the centrifugal loads will push as a bullet the blade toward the tip. Okay, but I have the casing. Here, I'll make the casing thicker and I'll prevent that the blades, if it breaks, go through the casing and will hit the aircraft, cutting a window, hoping that it will not hit you where you are seated there, no? It's a 1 kilogram projectile. Bullet, okay? And you don't want to be hit by that. But we prevent that making the casing a little thicker to contain this event that we try however to avoid. But if a disc will broken, cannot be contained. I should need a casing that is so thick to contain such a big component rotating so fast, no? And so, if a case, there are cases where there is one case in which an airplane was flying and the disc broke, the casing was not, of course, able to contain, it go through all the aircraft and all the other part of the aircraft, and anyone know where it finished, no? It went kilometers away, no? Luckily, it doesn't take no passenger. But you cannot allow that, of course. And so, you have to protect the disk really a lot. From temperature, how you do that? You push cool air here and you protect with the shields how much as possible, metal shields, the hot gas to hit the disc. To try to have disc at a much lower temperature of which I have here. I need high temperature here because I transform temperature in thrust. I don't need high temperature here. So in this part, I have cool air that arrives from where? From the compressor, before the combustor. It's the combustor to increase the air. So I need air with high pressure. I take it at the exit of the compressor. I take some air and instead to push them towards the combustor, I take it and I push in this part to cool all this critical zone because all this part is rotating at the same velocity of the rotors. And it's so big that I could not think it could be broken. Okay, these are the main characteristic of a blade, no? The other one is that, okay, I want to contain the flow inside there, but in reality, I want to contain the flow here, no? It's true that I don't want the flow to bypass here. Let me do again this design, this sketch here. So this part, I had the rotor and the casing, no? Okay, I said I put here two fins, to prevent the flow to go from here to here. But the blades are single blades. No? This is one, this is the other one, then there is another one, and so on. No? But the flow, I don't want to go from here to here and from here to here. So what I can do is to link all these blades together at the tip, making a
shroud. You can see it here. It's not easy for me to explain. Should I delete it? Okay, so you have this blade, but over the blade I put this, and here will start the new blade, so the flow will be compelled to don't go this way thanks to these fins.
Are this one design?
But also will try to remain, to be compelled to do the work by this shroud that will prevent to go there, no? And the same for the veins. Also the vein is this.
I know a lot of info altogether, no? And will not, in reality, will ask you not to design a new turbine. Will ask you just to think of the design of a profile, and later we will explain you, Marco will start now, what specifically a profile will have to do. From a mechanical point, I hope something has been explained to you by Professor La Rocca from aerodynamic point of view. After Marco, I try you to give a few info about the aerodynamic needs of an airfoil. The basic one is the one I say, accelerate, make the rotor turns and so on, no? But this is the good part. Then there is the bad part, secondary flow and so on, and we have to remove those. So what we'll ask to you is now, if you have more or less understood how a turbine works, no? Now we focus on the airfoil. And therefore, the first objective on an airfoil is to resist, because if it breaks, the flight will go down. The second one is to push the flight. Let's start to see how to make what it means to resist for an airfoil, and then I'll tell you what is good and what is bad from our point of view. No? And next time in the 8 hour, we'll try together to imagine, thanks to infinite possibility given from additive manufacturing, if we could do something different. Because we have always done these easy shapes, accelerate and make rotation. It's not flexible, but it's thin sheets of metal, no? And so, because the fins are instead covered of very hard material, when the fins go, they cut it. No? Because mainly it's there as complete material to prevent the bypass, but in reality it has a lot of holes that make it not strength and so cuttable from the...
If you take on a combo without the shroud, you can flex it, but when it is braced to the casting part, it is so rigid.
For example, what we are asking you is to think what additive could take as innovation in the engine. One of the innovations we are already doing is on the Onicom. The Onicom has this shape. This shape that is similar to what the bees do. With the awning chairs and so on. This shape has a lot of free space and not a lot of sheet material. No? And so when the things come to it, they cut. What we have discovered, and we need Honeycomb because this is easy to be done with the manufacturing process, is a sheet pushed and then obtained this material and then linked to other parts similar. Okay? But what we have discovered is instead of Honeycomb, you do the same concept by Lausanne. Something similar, but done in this way, it has more or less the same properties. It's still easy enough to be cut by the things that are harder, but the flow, in this case, if here you have Lausanne instead of Honeycomb shapes, the flow will be -7%. To bypass. Why? Because somehow here they form some vortices that will reduce a given gap 8 the flow. No? And this is possible thanks to additive manufacturing. Because without it, we were compelled to do it this way. Okay? This is a, of course, you could not know about this problem. Perhaps some of you have some special knowledge because of an hobby, I don't know, no? But we are not asking you. This has been discovered, I don't know by whom, and tested and so on, no? But it's a new possibility given by additive for us. So we have already some ideas, and at the end of the course, probably I'll give you, at the end of the workshop. But what we would like to see from you is to imagine a different shape of the airflow. So not the Honeycomb, but the airflow. No? Without giving you too much ideas, but only what you need to know to understand how it works.
Okay, we do a 5-minute break. Okay.